shit glow, make a shit go crazy and fast and ta-ta. Red food, the dude, a true Marty Vodka.
I'm true to the game too. It's called beer pong and I can't lose. I got a bunch of bad bitches in the back with some rock on tap and a little bit of great goose. Ooh, oh yeah, we killing shit. With our money, we diligent. So here's a sorry in advance. No hard feelings, bitch.
Sorry for party rocking.
People always say that my music's loud.
Sorry for party rocking.
Neighbors complain, say turn it down.
Sorry for party rocking.
Haters don't like, we got the spotlight.
Sorry for party rocking.
When they talk shit, we just be lying.
Sorry for party rocking.
Yeah. in your suite.
Find Kerrigan.
Crazy crowd we have here. It's fantastic to have you along. Welcome back to the StarCraft II World Championships Europe Final. It's just how they do it here in Stockholm. We're at the Ericsson Globe live coming for the DreamHack guys behind the scenes, of course, doing all of the production and sound. They've been fantastic so far. We hope you're enjoying it wherever you're tuned in all over the world, whether it be a barcraft or whether it be at your home and just taking it gently. So let's take a quick look at the schedule. We've already had a ton of games this afternoon, but let's have a quick check up there. As you can see, Slivko, Grubby earlier on, Thor Zane playing really well. The next game up will be Vortix versus Bly in the next few minutes. But before we do that, what we thought would be nice would be to check out the people of Stockholm and see what they made of StarCraft II.
Det var en trevlig pojke. Han tyckte jag om.
Han gillar öl i alla fall, det syns.
Ja, det här är en fotbollshuligan.
Vad tror han jobba med?
Mekaniker.
Jag är så dålig på fotboll, men han spelar säkert fotboll.
Jag tänker så här, what the fuck. Hans styrka är att dricka öl, tror jag.
Ja.
Ja. Hur får man det är en bra på beer pong.
Hur får man den styrkan?
Genom att så här, vara fotbollshuligan.
Den verkar ju lite störd.
Han jobbar på lager tror jag. Aha. Han packar någonting.
Ja, men det är ju Tisla såklart. Det är ju Day Nines storebrorsa. Han kastar ju också StarCraft tillsammans med Artosis. Han kom dit innan Artosis och han var den första som gick med i EMG, alltså eSports Media Group. Så att han är, alltså, han har en egen agent och allt sånt där.
Ah, speechless! Fan vad värt!
That is so funny. I love that. Dude, the people of Stockholm are really smart. They pretty much nailed you.
I don't know how they got it, man. I am a alcoholic football hooligan, man. I meet the match.
Oh, you know what's so funny as well? Do you know what's funny, guys? It's like I saw Artosis sitting there laughing at that. And guess what, dude? You've got one too.
Oh, God.
Oh, no.
So let's take a look at Artosis.
Ja, det är en artist från Ryssland.
Jag tror att han är pokerspelare.
Där har... Oj.
Tror han är bra på poker?
Nej, han ser ganska knäckt ut så jag tror han har bränt alla pengar.
Nej, snälla.
Den där killen är osäker, det är därför han slänger av den där blicken.
Och that's it, liksom.
Vad tror du han tycker om ost?
Om ost? Han tycker nog om ost. Ost är inga problem för honom.
Han skulle i och för sig kunna vara vegetarian eller något sånt där, va?
Det är mer korv och salami, tror jag. Sådana ryska liksom specials.
Han är inte tjock eller överviktig på något vis.
Här har vi en hunk.
Lite överklass tror jag. Lite bortskämd. Svårt att hitta sin plats i livet.
Hur skulle du reagera om någon gav dig den här blicken?
Ja, skulle jag smälta.
Ser ut att gå i skolan. Någon gång, gymnasiet. Vänta på lektion. Slut på sig.
Är jag med Dawson's Creek?
Ja, men något sånt. Något sånt, tyvärr.
Artosis, han bor i Korea. Han kastar StarCraft professionellt för GOM TV och åker. Han gör mer casting utomlands nu för att han har ett barn som han måste tjäna mer pengar för.
That is so funny.
They pretty much nailed it.
They pretty much nailed it.
What do you want, right?
I can't believe they got the vegetarian thing.
Yeah, that's weird. Well, the other guy didn't, right?
Yeah, I know.
I like Russian sausages or something.
Guys, you, have you pulled, by the way? There was a lady in there that was schmelt.
She was a little bit, but...
I feel like schmelting every time I look at you too, Artosis. I don't know.
Do you know what the funny thing is we've actually called them a married couple already this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, your casters for this afternoon, Tastosis!
What's up, guys? We're here in Stockholm. Are you excited?
Met today, but she's doing a fantastic job. Here to introduce the players once more. Big round of applause, please, for Rachel.
You're too kind, Red Eye. The real stars of the show are our players, of course, so please join me in welcoming to the stage, from the Ukraine, Bly. And on my left, representing Spain, please welcome Vortix. Gentlemen, you are two players who have recently emerged from other shadows. You, from your brother Lucifron's shadow, when you placed fourth at IEM and Gamescom. And you, sir, when you emerged over White Raw to represent Ukraine. So what is it like now, standing in the spotlight?
It's funny.
Hilarious.
Yeah, I guess it's funny.
Well, one of you majored in computer science and the other in accounting. Which do you think helps more for StarCraft 2?
I think it doesn't really matter for StarCraft 2.
No, I think economics are quite important in this game.
Sometimes, but not much actually.
Well, gamers, is there anything you'd like to say to each other before we start this match?
Good luck. You will need it.
Okay, play my best.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. You can shake hands. Let's get these games underway. Nick and Dan, take it away.
Great work, Rachel. And again, I want to just say one more time, we are so happy to be down here in Stockholm. You guys are awesome. This has been a blast so far.
This crowd has been killing it. We've been watching from back there through the screen.
Yeah.
Backwards. But I'm just so excited, man. We're finally out here in the front, and it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. The venue is excellent, and the games so far have been really, really excited. Oh, thank you. I will come try to abduct you later, but I have to cast right now. for these two players especially, I think it's going to be a great match. Vortix, I'm a huge fan of this guy since Gamescom.
Yeah, and, Bly, winning in Ukraine is insanely, insanely hard to do because they have such a deep player pool, players like Cass, Whiteraw, Damaga, Strelok. It's one of the toughest countries in the whole world, so the fact that he came out of there in first place, Vortix is going to have his work cut out for him.
Yeah, exactly. So I think it's going to be a fairly even match. And again, with Vortix, I get so excited watching this guy play. At Gamescom, the Broodlord usage was off the hook. I loved it. Do you know how close are we to getting this game started? Are they ready?
Well, it looks like Vortix is ready. We'll check.
Yeah, let's get some confirmation. Are you guys ready? It is awesome in here. I can't wait to get this game going, man.
Yeah. ZVZ, this is our first of today. We've been casting a little bit in the back, guys. We did a PVT, Mana versus Demuzzle, really great series. And then Lucifron, the older brother of Vortix, we got to cast him actually beating Happy, the Russian player.
And he was playing really well. I mean, really aggressive style. It actually looked a lot like Bomber when we were watching him play. Oh, and by the way, before we start this game, I think most of you guys are probably familiar with us, but I have to ask you guys, are you familiar with the GSL? All right. Good. If not, that's really weird that you're here. But if you want to see more of us, please check us out at golemtv.net. That's where you would see our normal stuff that's based out in Seoul. Are we ready, Anardosis?
I think they are ready.
All right. We got the game countdown started. So we're going to get this going. As ZVZ, you have any predictions, Artosis?
I'm going to go with Bly just slightly here, but I wouldn't be surprised if Vortix took him out.
Yeah, I feel like Vortix, maybe ZVZ, I wouldn't favor him as much as I would, for instance, a ZVP. But I could be wrong. We'll have to see. So we're going to get this game up on screen. So let's introduce these players. I want you guys to show a lot of love for both of these guys. I want the people at home to hear this. In the upper left, we have our first Zerg player, one of two. Give it up for Vortix.
And as we see there, he can solve a Rubik's Cube in under 30 seconds.
Damn.
Takes me a lot longer to peel off all the sticker stasis.
And put him back on in the order you feel necessary. In the bottom right, we have a very solid Ukrainian player. Give it up for Bly. All right, so our map is Ohana. It's a one-on-one map.
Yeah. So one of our smaller maps overall.
Yeah, it absolutely is. It's not like Whirlwind or something else. It's just massive. Mm-hmm. And of course, on a one-on-one map, you do know your opponent's starting location. So there are special strategies that you can tailor to, depending on the matchup, to that map so that you can punish your opponent early on.
Oh,
unlike a four-player map, for instance.
Yeah. I mean, if they play Tal Dorim, which I believe is actually the third map in the set, the second map's going to be Daybreak, third map Tal Dorim, if I recall correctly, that's going to be a map where you can't really do things like the 6-4. It gets a little bit more dangerous. You have to send out a drone quicker. I mean, you can, but if you're going to do it, this is a better choice for it.
Yeah, absolutely. So, nice sign. So we got, it's starting to fill up more and more here as the day passes on. And I got to say, man, we are so excited to be out here in Sweden. We are so excited to be out here in Stockholm. We wanted to go to Stockholm forever, guys. So thank you so much for having us down here. And it's going to be a little bit before this game picks up.
Yeah, they're doing basically the same builds. I mean, yeah. A lot of early game ZVZ, you can just watch the production tab. You don't even have to look at the screen.
Yeah, that's true. And, we get the pool done, then what we want to do is start counting. How many wings are each of these guys going to make, they're going to get, maybe just four. See them making more, they're probably going to try to end the game a little bit quicker.
Yeah. Well, both of them getting gas just a little bit quicker for Vortex here, but not a huge deal. That might, you know, he's going to get his speed just a few seconds quicker,
right.
And the odds of that making a real difference in this game, pretty low.
Yeah, absolutely. So as you can see now, both of them getting their queens. And yeah, it is going to be a best of three, but this first match definitely going to set the pace here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, unlike, for instance, a GSL, where the player has about a week or two to prepare for that specific best of three or several best of threes that he's going to go into. Tournaments such as this one, it works a little bit differently. We get to see who's actually playing their best this weekend overall.
Yes, for sure. And, you know, this is such a hard marathon of a tournament. We're doing most of it today and then finishing up just the very tip-top tomorrow. So today, everyone has to perform if they want to hit that top six and get a spot at the Blizzard World Championships.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, some of these games, if you can do a best of three that, let's say, takes an hour and 45 minutes to finish, I mean, you're going to be exhausted going into the next one. So stamina is key here. And we have one Zerglin over here. He's just trying to take out any drones that he possibly can. And even if he doesn't kill any of these drones, when the drones are forced to move, they're losing mining time.
Yeah.
So anything like that is just something that's going to give you a little bit of a leg up.
That's right. Now, both players have snuck Lings into each other's bases, so they're going to see that they're basically playing exactly the same here. Both of them are getting speed. Both of them are mining a little bit of gas. They both have a lot of drones, which means, of course, there's not hidden Zerglings anywhere on the map.
Right, right.
So everything here is completely standard. Both players should feel safe, and in fact, look at that mirror Baneling nest.
Yep. Notice they put that out in the front because they do want some obstructions there in case, let's say, they do get mass Ling. But then you can use the queens along with the buildings to kind of build a wall. And we can see here with Vortex that he is planning on not attacking into his opponent because of the spine crawler. That just tells us right away, you know, when you have static defense like that, you're not going to want to leave.
Yeah, and in fact, we have a spine crawler going up for Bly as well. They're very useful for counterattacks as well. So, you know, it's good to grab a spine crawler about this time because if they come in with Ling Baneling, well, you can hold it with Banelings, but if you have a spine crawler there as well, you're going to hold it very easily.
Yeah, it's Yeah, you're absolutely right. Looks like we have the second extractor coming down here now for both players, actually,
and
as they continue to drone up.
Both of them are getting a lair at this point. Vortex, though, going for all of his gases. Now, this is the first real... Oh, no, it's not a real difference, everybody. They're actually both doing it.
We have more additional gases coming down here as well. Looks like the Lings here of Vortex are going to get inside the main and do some scouting. He'll see the lair. He'll see that their two gases have been taken there. He'll probably loop back around. Oh, nope, he got that last Ling. I was going to say he'll probably loop back around into the natural, but that was stopped.
Now, Vortex did get that scout off and saw the lair for sure, but at the same time, Bly sees the extra two gases, so he doesn't really need to send the Lings in. Why would you have all those gases if you weren't going for a lair?
Right, right. And so the lair's going to finish here. Now, do you think we're going to see Mutas? Are we going to see Infestor play, perhaps, Sartosis?
I tell you, with all four gases up for both players, I wouldn't be surprised if they both go Mutalisk. And two-base Muta is pretty popular right now. Look at that. Both them throwing down Spires at approximately the same time, but Bly getting that third hatchery up a little bit quicker.
And as we can now see, Vortex is going to get that third up here. He might be able to force a cancel, though, over here. There's not a lot of HP. And if he does not cancel this in time, that will be minus 300 minerals. And it's getting closer, closer. Canceled at the last second. Very nicely done. And now, funnily enough, Vortex is the one who's going to have the third base lead.
Oh, and he went right back, and he's actually going to get it again, it looks like. And it does force a second cancel. Even gets the drone, and he's going to get out of there. Really well done by Vortex.
Yeah, especially for, you know, the mid-game and the late-game, you have to get those extra gases up at the third base. So to slow that down a little bit is actually pretty huge.
Yeah, and right now we actually have Bly buying a reasonable amount of Banelings. He's getting quite a few. They look defensive. Vortex, of course, making a few as well. You have to get careful at this point as people spend their excess minerals on Zerglings and try to deny that third base. But Bly looks like, okay, he's actually going to get a little bit more aggressive with this, but Vortex sees it coming.
He does, and that means he's going to have more time to prepare. Of course, it's so important. Oh, my God!
Whoa, right, and actually hitting a lot of those Baneling eggs.
Yeah, actually denying that.
Bly has a really good spread on Banelings here. Some of the Banelings walking out here for Vortex. He's starting to damage the Banelings a little bit, and that's a good idea to do so he can actually kill them a little bit quicker. He doesn't want them to actually get up here into the drones. At the same time, Zerglings hitting that third base, and
Nice. Takes out a lot of drones over there. Meanwhile, the Lings over here are attacking that extra hatchery. It looks like they might be able to get it, but then Morling's been here to try to defend and deny.
But Bly has too many, and look at this. It looks like he should be able to get this third base down.
It's getting
low.
That
is a huge moment for him.
And it's gone. Taking out that additional hatchery, that's huge.
Because
when you got two guys going for mutalisks, and one of them, you know, has a third base with the extra gases, that's going to mean a lot.
Yeah, it really will. And in fact, Blyze is going to finish up pretty quickly here. He has his defensive mutas, and as long as he just continues to produce mutalisks as much as he can, and in fact, he's adding queens as well, he should be able to hold on to this with the help of a few banelings.
All right, the lings are now being pushed back out. And I got to say, Bly so far has been playing really well. It was really nice to see that he managed to take out that hatchery there. And we're going to see where Vortex takes the game from here. Now we have Vortex's mutas heading south right now, and they're going to try to hit Bly's main to take out some drones. And, you know, it's kind of tricky in muta versus muta and ZBZ, because you can always avoid their mutas and just hit the other ones. Here they come now, taking out the queen.
Oh, some very nice mutalist craftsman. Look at that. He gets in and he gets out. Oh, he sees an extra muta there and almost takes it out. A great move by Vortex. And even though Bly killed that, oh my god, his circling's over to third base. He's going to take out the queen, but he should be able to save the hatchery.
All right, now the mutas have managed to chase out those lengths, but then meanwhile, Vortex's mutas coming now in towards the main. He doesn't have queens here to defend, so Vortex does back off. Meanwhile, this hatchery almost complete, and he really needs to get that up and running because he needs that additional gas.
Yeah, that gas is so crucial. If you get more mutas, you're probably just going to win, both of them getting that plus one mutalist carapace. And in fact, Vortex being really aggressive here. He has to be careful, though, because by now, Bly should be purchasing more mutas than Vortex is.
Yeah, and this is one of those situations where if the mutas meet the other mutas, you can't actually run away from them.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to fight because mutas can move while shooting in the air. And now we see he's going to open up these rocks, but Vortex is going to move in here. This could be deadly.
He's going for it. Now they have to target down each other's mutas. That plus one armor actually finished first for Vortex, so he's taking a small lead in this battle.
It looks like with the muta count here, when it's 11 to 11, it's neck and neck right now.
And Bly actually has a queen under there. So the queen plus his plus one armor finishing up, that combination is going to force Vortex to actually run out of here. And he's got to be careful because Bly may be able to pick off a few.
Yeah, that's exactly right. We also had some lings that came in there as well, which hit with the other lings on the ground. Now, I didn't really see. Did you actually catch who was actually ahead? On that one?
At that exact battle. Well, Vortex is the one that has a lot of lings left. Bly has a little bit more of everything except drones. It's 51 drones to 44 drones right now. We have 31 lings out for Bly, only 3 for Vortex. You know, he went in there, he attacked into that defensive position. Bly started to win. It was a really good timing, though, because the plus one armor for Vortex was a little bit quicker. So, and that's why he didn't die to the extra amount of mutas.
And, you know, you got to keep in mind that, you know, we're inside Bly's base, so there's going to be more and more mutas popping out. Oh. And it looks like we actually can throw the game back up on screen. That little hiccup is gone now. So, anyways, what I can see right now that I'll tell you guys is that mutas chasing mutas. And as you can see, the Lynx now went up here to the top center to get the third base. It's not clear if he's going to be able to take it out, though. More mutas are coming up here to try to defend. The HP is pretty low.
Well, right now we do have the mutas of Bly coming up. He's trying to target them down. A lot of low hit point mutas here for Vortex, and Bly looks like he's taking a little lead. And in fact, his mutalist count is at 10 against 4, and this could actually be something that ends the game, Tasteless.
Yeah. Once you actually get this far ahead, it just starts to snowball. And now we see that the third hatchery is being taken out. Vortex's answer is to counterattack with some of his lings down here. I don't think it's going to be enough. Meanwhile, Vortex desperately trying to save this third hatchery. I don't know if he's going to be able to do it, Artosis.
No, I don't know either. We do have queens popping up, but more and more mutas. And he GG's. Bly
nice.
With a win in game number one.
Really well done in that first game. He looked really solid.
Oh, yeah, he really did. It just was solid play. You know, he had to cancel his hatchery twice, which is really, really painful. But then he went over, did his own damage. You know, he held the battles very well. Vortex did some great harassment, though.
And that guy is right. They can fly. What's the deal with that? Oh, thank you. I'll be somebody's beaver. I'll take that.
Why not?
Well, what do you think he needs to do to kind of recover from here?
Well, you know what?
Vortex is very good. He's very good at attacking. His multi-pronged harassment's very nice, as we saw. You know, he got behind a little bit on that third base and was hitting the main, then running out, then running in with Lings to the third. He needs to do stuff more like that.
Yeah, you know, I wonder what our next map is actually going to be. Actually, do we have that up
it's
on
the screen?
It's going to be Daybreak. Okay, great map. I think it's actually, well, actually, personally, it's my favorite map in StarCraft II. But another one-on-one map can usually lend to some pretty long games.
Mm-hmm.
Third base and fourth base, so important. This is one of those maps where it gets really interesting if you end up with two guys going Infestor Roach, you know, how they're going to engage each other.
Yeah, that's
There's
true.
Lots of hallways. Mm-hmm. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, and this is also a map that, you know, back when Double Evo Ling plus Infestor got popular, we saw that a lot on this map because it is kind of long, and the speed of the speedlings is really good at running around. So we'll see if they mix that in. But I think it is going to be more Roach Infestor play. But
I think
of course,
so.
You can never count out Mutas, because Muta into Roach Infestor against just Roach Infestor, if you execute just perfectly, is pretty hard to stop.
Yeah, that's actually very true. Muta's kind of an interesting unit. In that game, for instance, they're both stuck going Mutas because they both started out with Muta openers, and from there you can't necessarily transition into something else as easily. But, you know, when you got people who go Roach, and we tend to see a little bit more Roach on this map, you get a situation where the Mutas are only good in the mid-game,
yeah,
and then they don't quite have as much of a function.
Yeah, you know, you have to utilize them then, though. You can get that third base up, kill a lot of overlords. And then when the Infestors come out, if they don't bring Queens or Hydras, you can kind of spread them out and make your opponent waste Fungals.
Right, right. You can burn out all their Fungals, and they have to do something. So let's go and take a look at the bracket, actually, before we start this game. And as you guys can see, so the game we're doing right now, Blivers Vortex, on the other side, we have Rhett, and Artosis, my eyesight is actually
That's
so bad
Rhett
I can't
versus
read that.
Baby Knight.
Baby Knight, yep. Okay. So we have the winner here is going to face off against one of those two.
Yeah, and then on the other side we have Lucifron against Sake, and Stefano awaiting Thorzane versus Lowly. This is actually a pretty awesome bracket that we're seeing here shape up. We might have matches like Thorzane versus Stefano coming up. Lucifron and his younger brother have the chance of meeting up in the grand final. And these matches are getting more and more important because the top six here are going to advance to the World Championships.
Exactly. So you really want to get in one of those top six. I mean, obviously you want to win the whole thing too and get some money, but you definitely want to go there. It's great to see Stefano doing well. You know, him and DeMuslim got in this morning. Stefano doesn't even have his keyboard because his luggage was lost, so he's going to have to use his different equipment. But I guess he's doing fine, which is great, and I hope we get to cast some of his games later on.
All right, and it turns out we have a little message here. Lowly knocked out Thorzane.
Yeah.
I don't hear any cheering, guys. Lowly's a great player. All right, we're going to get into this game, everybody.
All right, guys. Make a lot of noise for me when I introduce these players, please. In the bottom left, losing that first game. Make some noise for Vortex. Can he come back? And his opponent in the upper right, playing very well despite having some hiccups early on in that game. Give it up for Bly. So much on the line here. You know, Heart of the Swarm is right around the corner. So, you know, this, you know, we don't know when it's going to be released, but, you know, this could be one of the last big Wings of Liberty tournaments.
Yeah.
You know?
And in fact, this is one of the biggest tournaments of the whole year, Tasis.
Absolutely.
The World Championship Series is like the new kid on the block as far as tournaments go.
But oh, yeah.
It fills this void where we get to see the best players from each country have a chance. You don't have to be a big sponsor guy. You can go in as an amateur and prove yourself against the very best in the world.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, as this game goes on, we're going to see what exactly these guys are going to tech to here. You know, it's you know, ZBZ, we always have to wait for the hatch and then the pool to come down, and then we have to wait until they start getting gas and spending it before we can really predict anything. But if you were one of these guys, Artosis, if you're in the booth, how would you open on this map?
Well, I tell you what.
Old
wow,
school.
That guy's old school.
Yeah,
right
it's
there,
old
man,
school joke
sure.
Right there.
But I feel like what Bly should be doing here is basically what he did last game. You know, just play your own style. Know that you're going to have to be a little bit defensive at times because Vortex always goes into some aggressive mode at some point in the game where he's going to start attacking you. If you can hold that and become efficient against that, then suddenly you have a pretty big lead.
You know, occasionally when you go up against these players that are really aggressive, is instead of like, you know, trying to counter with your own aggression, if you just let them attack into you, like feeding into you, they're going to lose too many units, and then you're going to pick up a lead that way.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so we do have Scouting Overlord here, seeing that additional base here. Now, this is all very basic, you know, StarCraft stuff. There's nothing too much that they can glean from this, except for the fact that nobody sent Lings yet, which means they both opened normally.
Yeah, and in fact, they're basically even right now. Bly started a couple Lings, but Vortex actually did not. He's just staying on drones a little bit longer, realizing that, well, you know, what am I really going to scout? He's probably doing pretty much the same thing I am.
Exactly. And in this matchup, Lings, they tend to use them to scout a lot early on. It's much easier to get inside your opponent's base with a Zergling than with a drone because they're a little bit quicker. So, you know, when you're playing ZDZ, you want to make sure that your ramp is all blocked up, or at least you could block it up at any point in time if you wanted to.
Well, right now, I mean, they're both completely even in just about every single way, making the exact same units, exact same structures. And as mentioned before, a lot of early game ZBZ, you can actually watch from the production tab. It's actually more informative in a lot of ways than what's going on the map, because the matchup is so tight.
Now, here's the lane. He's managed to get inside the main. Now, he's looking for anything. Is there a lair? Do I see additional, you know, how many drones is he getting? Anything. So a little bit of a mistake there by Vortex to let him inside his base.
Yep, and in fact, the Ling makes it out. That's a hero Zergling right there to go in, scout, and make it out alive, even with Queens of the Grange around. And in fact, we have Bly going for that quicker Baneling Nest.
And it looks like we're going to have the same thing here from Vortex a few seconds later. I wouldn't be surprised if we see Spinecrawler coming up next, and yes, there it is now.
And Bly is going to make his Spinecrawler, but a little bit later, just like last game. And it looks like these two are gearing up for exactly the same builds, this two-base Mutalisk play. Will the layer start very soon? I think so.
I think you're right, Artosis. So we got the Ling now coming in here. Let's see if Vortex's Ling can get inside of here. It does. Oh, no, it doesn't. Excuse me. It was denied by the second queen up on the high ground.
And look at that. The layer once again for Vortex, slightly quicker. Adding his gases now. We should see the layer starting for Bly in just a moment. Ready? It's going to happen.
Wait for it. Oh, see, there,
there it is. And
how do you do it, Artosis?
I'm really smart.
You wizard, you.
Well, you know, this is the one little thing about this, is that the slightly quicker layer does give Vortex that little timing that we saw last game, where he has plus one armor on Mutalisks before Bly. So Bly is going to have to open up a little bit more defensive and maybe, like, float his Mutas over a queen until his is done.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely correct. Now we got the drones going into the extractor. One of the easy ways to figure out what your opponent's doing, if you can't get too much intel beyond like how many gases they have, is the more gases they have, the harder they're going to be teching. Mm-hmm. I know it sounds kind of common sense, but if you saw four gases in a ZBZ and nothing else, like four extractors, and they're on two bases, you just would assume, okay, this has to be Mutalisks.
Yeah.
Or maybe some Infestor play, but you know, you can tell right away.
Yeah. Well, the Spire has started for Vortex, as we see, hidden at the natural there. And Bly, he's making a few extra Lings. Has started his Spire, and there it is.
All right, so the Spire's coming down here now. It is going to be another Muta versus Muta. The Banelings are morphing. Looks like he wants to hide this drone over here and make a hatchery, but of course, there's going to be an Overlord there to see it.
And instantly, the Speedlings are being sent, but Bly sending some down as well. Don't forget, he is making those Banelings. He wants to keep this hatchery alive this time. He doesn't want to have to cancel it twice like he did last game.
Yeah, a lot of the game number one was decided based off the forcing of the canceled hatchery or destroying the other hatchery, because that impacted the player's behavior from there.
Yeah, you know, so much of this exact mirror set of builds is, can you force cancels on your opponent's hatchery? Because if you can, they will over time just have a little bit less gas, you'll get a few more mutas, and that's what really matters.
All right, you can see he's trying to come in here with one of his lings just to kill the other Baneling. Baneling split up into pairs right now. Okay, he's going to try to come in through here, and he does go by. Uh-oh.
And, well, can Bly actually get anything done here? His Banelings are doing an okay job, but he's got to be careful of those two of Vortex.
All right, now, as you can see, Vortex is trying to avoid the Banelings down there. And what he really wants to do is just hit this hatchery. Let's see if he can actually get it.
And he sent in some Lings after that Baneling, and there you go. That was actually a pretty good trade right there. And Bly just barely comes out on top with a few more Lings.
And now you can see the hatchery is being hit pretty hard right now. We need some more links to come over here and buy some more time. You can see this one, he's trying to get him to kite the other lings. It's not working. Is he going to cancel it? It's about to finish.
Man, and he has to cancel at the last second. Bly taking a nice lead and, in fact, starting that plus one armor first. This is a great spot for Bly to be in. He can actually just go defensive for now.
Yeah, Bly is tearing it up right now. Now, when you get your Mutalisks out first, you get this really unique advantage because you could take out all of your opponent's overlords right away. And when it's a Muta versus Muta situation, there's a high chance that you're going to get supply blocked if you know you don't anticipate that coming up here. So we'll see if he gets a few more overlords if you know that's going to be the case.
Well, you know, right now we do have Vortex. Yeah, look at that, taking out yet another one. Bly down by a little bit of supply, but he overmade overlords to make sure that he wouldn't get supply capped. Because if he can't make the extra mutas, then suddenly Vortex will have a little timing where he can deal a lot of damage with the superior number. But as is, he's mining from his third, a full six drones on gas. Look at that gas income. Such a difference.
All right, so now he's hitting the main. Bly engaging. It's not clear, you know, who's actually in the lead here. Morlings also at the third. Banelings defending very well. And the Lings are going to have to retreat out of here right now.
And Vortex is just having a hard time doing the damage he needs to do. He still has a good shot in this game, but every moment Bly is getting a little bit further ahead. He's mining a lot more gas. He's defending well. And Vortex's third hatchery is not even done yet. It's just finishing right this second.
All right, as you can see, he's starting to use those gas geysers there at the third base. And let me check something on your computer. How many mutas do they both have?
It has 19 for Bly, 17 for Vortex.
So tough situation for Vortex. Now, Vortex, target fire is right. He still can win that fight, but that's a pretty tall order there. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, he sees the mutas are in the middle of the map, so he's going to try to fly in here and hit some drones. Actually going to go for this extractor because he says, all right, less gas, less mutas for you, and flies back out.
Exactly. It's a really nice move, but Bly looks like he's caught him, and right now Bly does have a small mutalisk advantage. In fact, his rally point's closer, and Vortex realizes this. Bly destroying a lot of mutas there.
Yeah, Bly looking untouchable right now as Vortex is heading back home to make it even worse. Lings come down here towards the third base. It looks like Vortex will manage to defend it, but there's also Lings here for Vortex attacking into Bly. I don't know if he's going to get that much. We'll see.
And in fact, the Lings going up into the main base, but that's allowing a lot of hits from the Zerglings of Bly. Bly's supply getting a little bit higher. They're trying to go after some of these queens. Nice transfuses going down, and the mutas come back, so Bly will stabilize.
It looks like you know, that little attack there by Vortex did force Bly's mutas to fly away, but here's the problem is that they're going right back towards Vortex's base now. Vortex with 18 mutas, and as you can, I think there's, what, 21 over here for Bly?
It's right around there, Tasis, right now. It's 23 to 20 with Bly in the lead, but Vortex is getting plus one attack, so if he can live till then without losing mutas, he'll be in good shape. But here we go. The mutalisk battle has commenced, and Bly just looks like he may have too many.
The queens are coming up here to try to help out, but I don't know if it's going to be enough. Again, this is one of these things that snowballs once you start to lose too many mutas, and it looks like just barely...
Wow. Vortex pushes him back with the help of that queen.
Yeah.
By the narrowest of margins.
And, I mean, they were target firing each other on the specific mutas there back and forth. So that was a pretty tense moment. That was a nail biter right there. As you can see now, Bly peeks inside the main. He's going to have to run out. At least one of those Zerglings survives.
That's right. Well, Bly is going up in mutas just a little bit still. But Vortex is about to have plus one mutalisk attack done. And that is going to make quite a difference. Not as much as plus one armor, but having one more upgrade in Muta versus Muta is gigantic.
All right, the Lings, you can see he wanted to get some drones there. He does back off for a little bit. And it looks like he's going to be upgrading air attack now.
Vortex coming into the third base again with some Lings, going after these Banelings, not knowing really how close those are to finishing. That's danger right there. But he is brave, going to take out this queen so easily.
And also Vortex now is hitting the main here for Bly, taking out a lot of drones. The Lings over here also, okay, looks like if look at this extractor. He tries to transfuse it, doesn't work, but did Bly actually just corner him?
And, well, Bly is doing a great job, but he's losing a lot to these Lings. But what he really needs to do is win the Mutalisk battle, and in fact, he's up 12 to 10. I don't know if that's enough, especially with the plus one Mutalisk attack.
Yeah, you can see he's trying to target everything down there. Nice micro here, though, by Vortex. And actually, once again, he forced him to turn around. Meanwhile, the hatchery's destroyed.
Wow, Vortex just bringing it to Bly this game, and it looks like he should be able to take it.
I think we're going to see GG. There it is. GG. Really cool game.
Really well done by Vortex there. You know, he was up on the ropes for a bit, and he went for that plus one attack, whereas Bly decided, no, I want the extra couple mutas out there.
Right.
You know, I want to get an extra muta, which might net a couple extra mutas in the next battle. But over the long term, it didn't work out for him.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. That was one of those games where things got out of control very quickly. It looked like it could be even. But, you know, from what I can tell, it looks like Vortex is micing his mutas slightly better.
Yeah,
and targeting each other down.
I feel like he's maybe moving around his units a bit better as well. Some great counterattacks with his lings.
Yeah.
Some great harassment with his mutas as well. Killing that geyser in the main was a big deal.
Yeah, you know, it's smart because when I saw him fly the mutas towards the main, I initially thought that he was just going to get drones and fly back out. Mm. But, you know, to actually take out that extractor is so strong, so good that, you know, because how are you going to combat that? You need gas to combat anything, really, the mutas, unless it's a spore crawler.
Yeah, yeah. Well, all right, Tasis, we're going to go into game number three. It's going to be on Tal'Darim Altar, which is
okay.
Kind of a crazy map for ZBZ.
Yeah, well, this is one of these maps that we don't use as much anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's slowly going to fade away here. But, yeah, this is a very different map for ZBZ.
Yeah, well, let's talk about some of the reasons.
Sure.
There's no ramp, and no ramp going to the main base. A lot of builds aren't really done because you can block that ramp with two queens.
Yeah.
But in this case, you can't really do that. So that's going to add a little different thing, a little different feel into the game. Also, the third base, rocks are there. It takes a long time to kill those rocks. So that has to be taken into consideration. You can't run around your lings as much harassing if you are targeting down destructible rocks.
Yeah, it's a very different map, to make it simple. And we do see a lot of third bases sometimes not taken where those rocks are.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what to expect with this. In fact, we haven't even casted a game on this map in a while.
No,
so
not a, not
be
a
old
ZBZ
school
in
stuff.
Quite some time, in fact. I can't even quite remember. Maybe a Hey Pro game many, many months ago.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
Yeah, that's about it. But, all right, I mean, I'm excited to see how it goes. I actually feel like this map is going to be pretty good for Vortex. You know, his aggression and his running around with his units could be pretty helpful here without the ramp.
Yeah, I think you're right. This is one of these really open maps. It's really spread out. And like we said, it's flat. There's no ramp, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, there's a lot more ling play that can come into play here. So
It's
going to be pretty cool. What are your predictions, Artosis?
You know what? I thought Bly would win coming into it. I'm maybe leaning just slightly Vortex right now. Just slightly.
Yeah, I'm leaning slightly Vortex as well. How about you guys, the audience? Who's rooting for Bly? Make some noise if you support Bly. All right, and anybody out there cheering for Vortex? If so, make some noise.
Seems like Vortex might be a slight favorite over Bly with them.
There's a few decimals higher, I think.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, this game is now loading, and we're going to find out who's going to go down to the loser's bracket in a little bit here. So, show your support when I say these guys' names. In the upper right, in the red, winning game number two, give it up for Vortex. Making sure that earpiece stays in.
Yep.
And in the upper left, in the blue, winning game number one but losing game number two, give it up for Bly.
All right, so they are both on the top of the map. So that's pretty close overall. And don't forget that the natural base of Bly has its back to Vortex here.
Yeah, this is something very important to talk about.
Yeah, you know, like for instance, let's say that they both go to hatch muta again. The mutalist harassment from Vortex will be more powerful overall than Bly's because he can get right into that mineral line, doesn't have to fly quite as far.
All right, as you can see, they're setting their overlords out. Now, for those of you guys who are less experienced in StarCraft or don't play as competitively, a pro Zerg player will have a position for every single overlord. Like, for the first 10 that come out, they will have a special place on every single map for every single starting location that they can do to spread out. So it's really interesting when you see certain scouting patterns with overlords, and how they differ.
Mm-hmm. Now, we see mirror builds once again here. Every single building, every single drone within a couple seconds of each other. And, you know, I'm not surprised. This is really the style that these two have chosen. They're both very good, as we've seen. Both games were very close.
And they're going to get in here and see what each other are up to. Now, in StarCraft 1, it's kind of funny because in Zerg versus Zerg, there was really no way to stop an Overlord from getting into your base. So basically, you couldn't really hide anything in StarCraft 1 ZVZ. And the matchup kind of boiled down to you know, just two guys massing up mutas and trying to micro them as well as they possibly could. In StarCraft 2, it's a lot better because you have the Queen, which operates as an anti-air as well as an economy booster. So... I love it. I'm curious, though, like on this map, if they're going to go for, what do you think? What kind of tech pattern would you go for?
Well, I wouldn't be surprised if we see a few more Zerglings, at least at the beginning. You know, these two have been very conservative with their Zergling counts. In fact, already 4 and 6 being made in the previous games. It was 2 for scouting from both players, knowing that Queens could block everything off. But when you make a few more, when you get that speed pretty quickly, and in fact, a very quick Baneling Nest that is not out anywhere on the map, Bly obviously going to be going for some quick aggression, as is Vortex, because of this map.
Okay, so the Lings are now moving out. And, you know, it looks like he's going to be heading towards Bly's base here with Vortex. Vortex is heading towards Bly's base. We have a Spine Crawler up here. Now, this, as you probably noticed, this looks a lot different than a normal ZVZ that you'll see. And that's, again, all because of the way the map is shaped.
Mm-hmm. You know, if you cannot block off with some queens, some high hit point units, then it comes down so much to micro, which is why these guys are making some spine crawlers. That's really going to help out. If you don't have one, the aggressor oftentimes will have the advantage.
All right, the links are coming down here now. Will he get the queen?
It looks
like he will. Very well done. But he loses some extra zerglings for it.
Yep. So now that's going to allow Bly to attack back across the map. Note that link speed is like a second away from finishing here for Vortex. Ooh. Oh, nice move there.
Yeah, Vortex juking and jiving there, getting away from Bly's Lings, saving those two extras. That can always make a big difference.
All right, so more Banelings are on the way now.
You know, Vortex is going to be feeling pretty good at this point, Tasis. You know, he's killed a queen, and he has an extra queen. So his defense is going to be a lot easier. You're going to be able to pick off Lings and Banelings so much quicker when you have two queens. You're also going to get more energy for things like a transfusion because you don't always have to larva inject.
Yeah, exactly. All right, here comes that one Link. When you hear a scout, he just wants to get confirmation that it's what he suspected all along, that he's going to go ahead. Bly is going for Banelings here. Now, Bly is moving out with these Banelings.
Notice that they're all spread out so that enemy Banelings can't get them as easily. Roach Warren on the way for Vortex, so he's going to play the defense for now. Already laid some creep tumors to push out and utilize this choke area.
All right, the Lings come out now, but he doesn't want to risk going in there yet, so he doesn't know exactly what his opponent has. And, yeah, spacing of the Banelings is so important in this matchup. And I don't know, do you think he should even go in?
No.
I don't think he's actually going to, it's going to work. I think, yeah, he has to turn around.
Yeah, the defense there is just too strong by Vortex. He's done a great job knowing he has that extra queen, scouting a bunch of Banelings being made. It's the perfect choice to go ahead and grab a Roach Warren. Roaches are pretty immune to Banelings.
As you can see right now, Vortex still sort of stuck on a one base build right now. He would love to get in. Oh, okay, never mind. I spoke too soon. He will get a hatchery up over here. Meanwhile, Bly's hatchery with a little bit of a lead.
Yeah, it's time for stabilization here. They both have enough Banelings. Attacking each other is pretty difficult. But the lair is coming up for Bly. So he wants to tech up pretty aggressively here, whether it is going to be to mutas or to infestors. We'll have to wait and see. I think it's going to be the mutas again. But, you know, the roach tech I really like for Vortex here. If you go roach with Baneling, you can break through something like this relatively easily.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, big mistake by there, losing too many Banelings. And now these other Banelings are coming into attack, and I can't believe what little this attack has done so far. Takes out the Spine Crawler.
Yeah, Bly getting a little bit ahead there, but the Roaches do come out. He was trying to hide those, but he had to show them. Vortex making a few little mistakes there, micro-wise.
Yeah. So, I have to say that was pretty much a failed attack.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to get in there with the Banelings. You want to be getting stuff like drones. If you just take out some of their army, it doesn't really do anything. It doesn't really mean that much because you obviously lost the Banelings that you made too. So it just becomes somewhat of a trade.
Well, it's time to work on those rocks. And as mentioned before, you can't be aggressive if you're working on the rocks. And it takes a little bit with those Zerglings because of the armor on the rocks. But in the meantime, Bly is getting a Spire. If he can get that Spire up, this Roach Baneling style that we're seeing out of Vortex will fail. But it's a super powerful attack. And notice he's making a lot of Spine Crawlers realizing that his Lings alone will not be able to hold this.
Okay, the Roaches are coming. Obviously, Bly is aware of that since there are Overlords peppered all over the map. Note the interesting placement here, Artosis, of these Spine Crawlers. Okay, you know, he's now going to relocate them. I was confused when I saw that line of them kind of extending back to his main. All right, so Vortex is in position. Will he be able to get inside?
And we got a lot of defensive Banelings here. And, wasted Banelings, a lot of them. Now the Banelings of Bly coming out. He's just making the Roaches run back and forth with them right now so that his Spine Crawlers can do some extra damage. Beautiful hit with those Banelings. And, in fact, it looks like Bly may hold.
Yeah, I think he's going to hold. He completely deflected. I think he's completely deflected Vortex's attack.
Yeah, he really has at this point. Vortex is going to keep on going, though. You know, he has Roaches and Lings and no other tech. He needs to break through here before the Mutas start to destroy him, but the Spire just finished.
All right, so the Lings actually don't even manage to get inside the main. And yes, the Spire is finished, so we have some Mutalisks on the way. And once those Mutas hatch, the makeup of this game is going to be completely different.
That's right. Those Mutas are going to be able to clean up Overlords, kill off Roaches, kill off drones, do all sorts of things. And we don't even have really any anti-air for Vortex. He's still sitting on the same old hatchery tech. No layer yet, no evolution chamber, and he literally has two queens. So he's going to have two queens against a bunch of Mutas, and that is not a good place to be in.
All right. The Muta's now out, so he will try to start taking out all the other Overlords that are on the map. Making it lights out. And as you can see now, Vortex is actually supply blocked.
Yeah, this is a problem. He started one queen, but he still hasn't started an evolution chamber. So he's going to try to hold off Mutas with just one queen or two queens. And that's not enough.
No, it's not enough at all. All right, so it looks like Bly now going to come into the main here for Vortex. Now, we don't see a queen up there just yet. Here she is now. And taking out some of these drones. Oh, is he going to lose that one Muta?
It's like not quite pulling it back in time.
Just barely gets away.
And, you know, he could be doing a little bit more damage, but he's playing very carefully with it. He doesn't want to have his Mutas caught. He wants to be able to utilize those to perhaps take a third base to be able to transition himself as well.
All right. And now the third base here for Bly is going to be taken. As you can see, he's just moving around with the queens, trying to make sure that he can stop the Mutas at every single path that they take over here. And once again, just driven out. Not too much damage being dealt here from Bly.
That's right. And notice right now, Bly, he's still scouting a lot with these. He's picking off a lot of drones, but he sees that it's mostly spores being made and queens used for defense. So he's continuing to make Mutas, knowing that he will own the map until his opponent has out, you know, infestors, maybe some hydras, something like that.
Yeah, you know, these Mutas haven't really done too much damage, but they are at least forcing spore crawlers to be planted, additional queens to be made. So that's one thing that's going on there for Bly. Vortex, actually, if you notice, he's pushing his creep.
Yeah.
Which you don't see very often in Zerg versus Zerg.
Well, you know, he's going to be using a land army. He knows he can't go Spire later than his opponent went Spire. That wouldn't make any sense. So he's going to have to go for Infestation Pit. He's going to have to use Roaches. And that means he wants to get across the map very quickly with that army, as opposed to Ultra Mobile Mutas, which can just fly over anything. So it's a good choice for him to start spreading this creep.
Yeah, it's really good. Well, as you can see, no third base here for Vortex yet. And he really can't... He can't get a third base for a little while now because the Mutalisks are dominating the map. The only place that actually Vortex is safe is at home because the queens are there. They can move quickly on the creep. For the time being, Vortex is a little bit stuck.
And look at this. He's going over here to harass in the natural. He sees the infestation pit. His is a little bit quicker, but he hasn't started pathogen glands. And the Muta's killing off a lot of drones.
Yeah, he was actually okay losing a few Mutas there if he just got a few workers. 11 drones killed so far.
Yeah, that's really well done. In fact, Vortex is at 40 drones against the 53 of his opponent. In fact, Bly just started his hive. I really like this taste. It's the fact that his opponent is going for infestors means that he can actually tech up right away. Both Ultralisks and Broodlords are very strong against Infestor Roach.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. It looks like he's handled this basically perfectly. He realizes his opponent's teching in a certain direction, so he's going to tech himself as well. Meanwhile, you can see the Blaze Links checking up here at the top center to see if perhaps that expansion's been taken yet. It has not. And obviously, when Blaze sees all these creep tumors getting pushed out, he's probably saying to himself, oh, I'm going to be attacked by a land pretty soon here. I need to be ready and have some ground defense.
That's right. Well, his hive is finishing up. He's making a bunch of infestors. A nice little spine crawler wall here. And that's really where he's going to have to hold, because this attack from Vortex is going to come pretty soon here. He's pushing that creepy even more. His queens are even coming along for the ride. Those transfusions could be just so crucial.
Yeah, this is pretty scary. And we know he's about to attack because he did pull the queens, off of the creep. And they are so slow when they're off the creep. Looks like he does take out that Baneling here. But it's really this big mob of queens that's a scary part.
Yeah, even a lot of roaches being made by Bly right now. He doesn't want roaches, but he needs to make anything he can that has enough hit points to live through this attack. All he needs to do is hold on till that Greater Spire does finish. So this is a crucial moment in this game.
Now, it looks like he's going to go around over to, yes, to this space over here. Now, the problem is queens are so slow, off of creep that... it's actually very easy for Bly to just relocate his spine crawlers.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, he is relocating those right now as we see to that third base. If he can hold on to this third base, he will win the game. Vortex has to break through here.
All right, here he comes now. Infested Terran's being thrown down here. And we're going to have a lot of fungals. Now note that the angle here is not as that good here for Vortex to defend. But he's going to have to do something because... if he loses this base, he's in so much trouble.
That's right, and in fact, the spine crawler is doing so much damage here, but does Bly actually have enough? The queens still have a lot of energy. They can transfuse a lot of these very hurt roaches, and that's really going to enable him to push through.
The roaches are indeed pushing through now, hitting that up against the infestors over here, now driving him back. Now, does he go back and get the third hatch, or does he keep pushing? It's a tough call.
Well, he's going to go and continue to push, and that's what he needs to do, because if any Broodlords got out, he'd still have a chance. But getting up here, there's a Macrotcher. The drones are coming out, and this is looking really good for Vortex.
Nice fungal there on that group of roaches up above, and Infested Terran's now coming out here to try to combat Bly's army. Bly, I don't know if he should pull his drones or not. By the way, some of these queens in the back not doing as much damage as they could. We see a lot of transfuses being thrown down here as well that's allowing these roaches to push in here into the second base.
Well, the energy is almost gone off of all of these infestors, the queens as well. The roach count is equalizing quite a bit, 17 for Vortex, 13 for his opponent, but he might just have a little bit too much. Bly just barely can't hold on here.
All right, the roach is continuing to push forward. And if Bly can't stop this in the next minute or so, it's going to be GG. There's just no way that he can recover, as there are still more and more roaches streamlining from Vortex's base. Don't forget, he has that creep highway that can get them there even quicker.
And look at this. The supply is greatly in Vortex's favor. It's 116 to 44. Bly's only making 5 units at a time right now. And GG, well played. Vortex moves on.
Really, really well done by Vortex. He handled himself very well. That was a tough situation that he was in that game, but he really kicked some ass.
Oh, yeah, that was some superb play out of Vortex. You know, we both switched over a little bit and said, you know what, Vortex, he's a very good aggressive player. This map rewards aggressive play, and Vortex really showed that he knows how to do that.
Yeah, he played very well. It was a funky situation, but and by the way, that map itself is actually a very tricky map.